he did what, the only thing he knew how to do is he came down here and he said to his son that he was going to stay here and put it back the way it was. And that, I think that's really a neat thing. What we didn't realize was that while we're fixing the scar in this building, it's helping the survivors heal the scars they have. And I don't think anybody thought of it that way before.
So luck would have. I see it right on his joint. Rescue team that went in and got my son and Earhart out, probably came up this hallway and made a left into the area, drug him out. And he may have received a lot of his lacerations being pulled out of the rubble. His autopsy report stated that he had no broken bones, there was no blunt force death-risking injury. He died completely from smoke inhalation. And his lungs were completely filled with smoke, his nasal passages, his esophagus, his auditory canal, so which tells me he lived. He lived long enough to maybe try to escape or try to help Earhart out, one or the other. That was his friend who died of severe internal injury. Then the bodies were wrestled, picked up and carried out from here. I hate to be so graphic about it, but it's the reality that I've been living with, you know, since it happened. Those are the thoughts that you try to place yourself, what was he doing and how did he die, you know? So, this is it. It's all cleaned up now.
They allowed me a half hour or so just to stand there where his office was and possibly where his desk was. And I stood there and meditated, and I felt his presence, his spirit. And I felt that he felt that I was doing the last thing that I could do as a parent, is to find out and to let him know that I respected what happened to him, that I'm here to try to add it all up, to try to bring some sanity into it. And I told him that I wasn't going to leave until this project was done. I made a vow to him. And then I just continued on like any other worker. I joke around with the workers and fit in with the mix and let them know that I'm not anyone special. I'm just like they are. I have my problems with alcohol. I have my problems with physical inabilities. And they all realized that I was one of them. And they accepted me into their fraternity. And then I had my blues days where I couldn't even stand to walk out that door. I just wanted to listen and pray and cry. I've had those days.
When you're working daily, on a daily basis, hour for hour with a guy that's going through that, it's just sad for me. Gosh, look at what he's going through. A lot of times, you know, he wouldn't show up and I would be worried about him. It wasn't just me, it was the whole crew would worry.
Go into work to work. You don't go into work to seek compassion. 25 and 9, I blew it. If I go in there right now, all I'll do is go in there and what the hell am I gonna do? The hell am I gonna do? Drunk. Well, I'm not drunk. I'm kind of like depressed. Until something like this happens to you, you're not going to know how you're going to take it.
I just can't understand how anybody in their right mind could want to kill somebody so humble, so quiet, and so beautiful.
I've probably missed 10 days. Split it right down the middle. 5 for dental appointments and 5 for depression.
Why would they want to kill him?
Maybe 6 when depression really hits hard. It really hits you hard. Like when I put one of his songs on that he gave me, he actually gave them to me, it just tears me apart.
Pray for Matthew. Matthew.
It just opens up the wounds. Some people say, well, get rid of it. No, I'm not going to do that. Well, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to heal up and I'm going to do it the way I feel is best. I don't need a grief counselor.
What the heck did he do wrong? Matthew sang this to me before he died.
I might cry from 10 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock at night. Maybe I'll do it for 2 days, but sooner or later I'm going to realize I got to eat and I got to clean up my mess. So I go right back into the other like Flacco. Go to work. Before September 11th, I enjoyed every second of going to work. I never got depressed. Before September 11th, I was happy to have two or three beers and maybe a pint of whiskey. It was to quench my thirst, and I enjoyed it. I enjoyed a nice cocktail after work. The alcohol consumption got really bad. After September 11th, there wasn't enough beer or enough whiskey in the world.
How the hell do you get over? You're supposed to be able to get over this stuff.
When I came down here, that's when it started to really hit. It started hitting home. He was an only child. That's where we messed up at. We tried to have other children, but it wasn't in the cards. He was just an only child, the only son, the onlyness. The last words I said to him before he died were, "There's only one thing better than your kid." He goes, "I know, Dad," to me. And I gave him a high five at the train station. Sunday, September 9th. Quarter after 9, and at night, he had to catch the 9:35 train. And that was the last time I saw my son.